Hello and welcome to this snapcast in the series Atomic Theory. We'll be looking here at atomic emission and atomic absorption spectra, but the emphasis will be on atomic absorption spectra. We'll be looking at the origin of the spectral lines. In particular, we'll be taking a look at the Balmer series for hydrogen. We'll also take a look at the design of a spectroscope, an instrument designed for observing the spectral lines and for recording the wavelengths of the bands produced. We'll then go on to take a look at the flame ionization spectra for a number of metal chlorides. Just a warning here in regard to this topic. No topic I know jumps faster than this one, from the sublime to the ridiculous. In just one sentence you can jump from what is year 10 chemistry to undergraduate chemistry, like here for example. The second shell of electrons can hold a total of 8 electrons, but no two will have the same set of 4 quantum numbers according to the Pauli exclusion principle. So it's important that we attempt to bite off what we can chew, and there will be times when the theory goes well beyond your A-level syllabus. So long as you stick to what you need to know, the topic isn't as difficult as it appears. At the same time, this, as a topic, it stretches way into undergraduate and postgraduate chemistry. The topic, for example, that considers the wave properties of the electron, known as wave mechanics, is particularly difficult. But that's not something we consider in A-level. While Rutherford was doing his pioneering work leading to the discovery of the atomic nucleus, chemists were completing spectral analysis of different elements, and this is at the turn of the 20th century. They found that each element, when excited in its gaseous state, produced a unique spectral fingerprint of brightly coloured lines, which could be seen when viewed through closely separated slits. We'll see exactly what we mean by that shortly. Here is the hydrogen spectrum, hydrogen emission spectrum. The element most studied was hydrogen, which had 3 distinctively observable lines in the visible spectrum: the red, blue, cyan, and violet. Those were not the only particular lines, but the most observable. It was noted that the lines were always there, and that the spacing between these lines became smaller and smaller. What we're referring to here is, here's the space between the first two, and you notice the space here isn't as great. And if you look yourself in here, you can see the distance between the lines on the spectrum are getting closer and closer. And this interested them to know why. The first person to propose a mathematical relationship for these lines was J.J. Balmer, and we now call the hydrogen's visible spectrum the Balmer series. This is the absorption spectrum for hydrogen, and this is the so-called emission spectrum, and our emphasis is very much on the emission spectrum. Imagine here that you pass light through a sample of hydrogen. The wavelength range of the visible light goes from 750 nanometers here to about 380 nanometers here. This is increasing energy. You'll be aware that radiation, electromagnetic radiation, comes in the form of waves, where this distance between two peaks is the wavelength given this symbol here, lambda. If we compare that with a wave that looks more like this, for example, this here has got a shorter wavelength. Now, there are 3 terms that you should link together: energy, wavelength, and frequency. This wave down at the bottom here has got a shorter wavelength, but it's got a higher frequency. And this wave at the bottom also has a higher energy. So in terms of energy, you have a higher energy when the wavelength is smaller and when the frequency is higher. So I'll say that again. If the frequency is relatively high, so that the wavelength is relatively low, then the energy of that wave is relatively high. Pause and take that in. The wavelength of red light is longer than the wavelength of violet light. So red light is less energetic than violet light. Remember that memory aid Richard of York in Battle in Vain to remember the colours of the rainbow, or the colours that make up the visible spectrum. Richard of, we see orange around here, York yellow, Gained G for green, Battle, indigo and violet. On this side we'd have infrared, and on the other side of course ultraviolet. It's helpful to know that. Now go back to what I was saying a moment ago. I'd like you to visualize passing light through a sample of hydrogen. Now light is made up of an almost infinite number of different wavelengths of radiation, varying from 750 nanometers down to 380 nanometers. As the number of nanometers decreases, the wavelength is decreasing, which means the frequency is increasing and the energy of the wave is increasing. Now, stop and take a look for a moment and see what you can spot as a relationship between the top spectrum, the absorption spectrum for hydrogen, and the lower one, the emission spectrum. What's happening here is, as the light goes through the sample of hydrogen, some of the wavelengths of energy, for some reason, are removed from the light. Only some. The top spectrum then represents what's getting through. And if we take, for example, this particular band here, as the light goes through the sample is absorbing light radiation of this particular wavelength. The sample here, in terms of what the sample is emitting, it's also emitting, we can see here, wavelength of that same radiation, giving here a line on the emission spectrum. And here we see a band created, or a line created, in the absorption spectrum, indicating that the hydrogen, for some reason, absorbs energy of that specific wavelength. And similarly, we can see a link here. So the sample here of hydrogen, when light is passed through, for some reason it's absorbing energy or light of that specific wavelength to perform some specific task within the hydrogen. We'll see this is to do with electrons jumping up from their ground state energy level to higher energy level. And then down below we see in the emission spectrum the same sample of hydrogen is emitting energy of that wavelength, because some event is taking place within the hydrogen atom which causes energy of that specific wavelength to be created and emitted from the atom, or radiated from the atom. And likewise for these other lines that you see. Now this is giving us the idea of energy being absorbed of a specific wavelength, in other words of a specific amount, to cause an event to take place, which we later see is to do with an electron making a specific jump, going from one step to another specific step, and absorbing a very specific amount of energy, a specific wavelength of radiation, which happens to coincide with the color part of the spectrum, to make that electron rise to a higher energy level. What is also interesting is that in terms of what the atom does next, we see that in returning these electrons and returning to lower levels, it shouldn't surprise us that the fact that we get lines in the emission spectrum that correspond with lines in the absorption spectrum. These electrons are jumping back down, And some of these steps, obviously, in terms of energy, correspond. In 1913, it was Niels Bohr, a Danish scientist, who solved many of the problems at the time by proposing that the electron revolves around the nucleus of the atom with a definite fixed energy in a fixed path without emitting or absorbing energy. This is in its normal ground state. The electron in the hydrogen atom exists only in a certain definite, only in certain definite energy levels. So we're beginning to think here about, or trying to come up with an explanation for the lines on the spectrum. It's around this time that we have a huge jump in thinking. Up until this time, energy was considered to be a continuum. And we can use the analogy here between a staircase and a ramp. In a continuum is like the ramp here. Where, if I decide to jump from here to somewhere down the ramp, do I have to land on a particular position? Because I do if I'm jumping down the steps. I can only go from here to a particular step, there perhaps, or there, but there are only fixed positions where I can jump to. The staircase is likened to the idea of discrete levels, discrete meaning separate, whereas the continuum is more like the ramp. Now, it used to be considered that you could jump from one energy level to any other energy level, and that indeed if you had two different energy levels here and another one right next to it, that you could always have an energy level in between. And indeed you could keep splitting this distance over and over and over an infinite number of times, just as, for example, if I take the number 1 and I keep dividing it by 2, I can keep doing that forever. And so we had this idea of the continuum, that you could keep splitting the distance between two different energy levels. You could keep splitting it forever and ever. But with Planck's theory, the quantum theory, we moved to the notion that this was not the case. That while if you took two particular energies here, which represent two different wavelengths, we take the energies as electromagnetic radiation, you can have two different wavelengths that are very close together. In other words, the energy of the two different waves is very close together. Now, between these two different wavelengths, you might have a huge number of other wavelengths somewhere between these two. But as you keep cutting it down, the difference between these, you will get to a point where you have got one particular wavelength, and right next door to it you've got another particular wavelength which represents a very, very tiny difference in energy. And in the continuum theory, it would have been considered that there was another, that you could keep splitting the difference between those two. But with the discrete theory, or Planck's theory, or the quantum theory, you do get to a point where you have this wavelength and you have the wavelength next to it and you have nothing in between. And this is the idea of the steps. Though these steps, represented by a staircase, fail to give the idea of just how tiny the difference is between one energy and the next, between one particular wavelength of radiation and the next wavelength of radiation. These energy levels then are called principal quantum levels, denoted by the principal quantum number n. You may have seen a separate snapcast where I dealt with the particle nature of the electron and we looked at the four quantum numbers. The principal quantum number n equals 1, it represents the shell. It's the shell closest to the nucleus of the atom and it has the lowest energy. When the electron occupies the energy level of the lowest energy, the atom is said to be in its ground state. So in the case of hydrogen, you're aware that when that electron is in the 1s level, then the hydrogen is in its ground state. If the electron occupies one of the higher energy levels, then the atom is in what's called its excited state. And an atom has many possible excited states. So here's what happens. When a gaseous hydrogen atom in its ground state is excited by an input of energy, its electron is promoted from the lowest energy level to one of the higher energy levels. The atom does not remain excited but re-emits energy as electromagnetic radiation. This is a result of an electron falling from a higher energy level to one of lower energy. And this electron transition results in the release of a photon, a specific packet of energy from the atom, where E equals HN. H is Planck's constant and N, the value of the principal quantum number, or the number of the shell, and is equals to the difference in the energy of the electronic energy levels involved in the transition. If a sample of gaseous hydrogen, in a sample of gaseous hydrogen where there are many trillions of atoms, then all of the possible electron transitions from higher to lower energy levels will take place many times. So if we've only got one hydrogen atom, then we're going to have one particular transition, or at least as it jumps up and down, a relatively small number of transitions, covering a small number of the possible jumps that could take place. But where you have a huge number of hydrogen atoms, many trillions, then you can imagine that all the possibilities are going to result. A prism can now be used to separate the emitted electromagnetic radiation. So you've got radiation in the form of electromagnetic waves being emitted from the sample, and you need something to analyze that. Even if it is colored light, one can't analyze it sufficiently well. And this is where we use the spectroscope. So a prism can now be used to separate the emitted electromagnetic radiation into its component frequencies. And remember, when we're talking about frequencies, we can define a particular electromagnetic wave by its frequency or its wavelength or by its energy. A wave with a relatively high frequency will have a relatively low wavelength and a relatively high energy. These are then represented as spectral lines along an increasing frequency scale. So the standard is to draw the spectrum, or to show the spectrum, in this direction with increasing energy, which means that it's increasing frequency, in frequency is going up, energy is going up, but that the wavelength, lambda, is coming down. Recall as well that as we go from left to right here, increasing energy, that the bands get closer together. It can be confusing that it depends on where you're reading the information from. Sometimes the spectrum is drawn the other way around. In other words, decreasing energy as you go from left to right. But as a standard way of doing it, you should always draw it like this. And certainly when you're looking to recognize it in examination papers, look to see it drawn in this fashion, where we have increasing energy from left to right or decreasing wavelength. And look for the bands, the distance between the bands getting shorter as we go from left to right and energy is increasing. Here's a hydrogen atom in its ground state. The electron is in principal quantum N equals 1. It's in the first shell. Here's a possible jump. It's made a jump from N equals 1 to N equals 3. And it's now in what's known as an excited state. You will be aware that within principal quantum number N equals 3, that you have three different sublevels. You've got the 3s, the 3p, and the 3d. But we're not going to that complication. The Bohr theory was a marvelous success in explaining the spectrum of the hydrogen atom. His calculated wavelength agreed perfectly with the experimentally measured wavelengths of the spectral lines. Bohr knew that he was onto something. Matching theory with the experimental data is successful science. More recent theories about the electronic structure of atoms have refined these ideas, but Bohr's model, taken from the early part of the 20th century, is still very helpful to us. For clarity, it's normal to consider electron transitions from higher energy levels to the same principle, quantum level. We'll see this in the case of the Balmer series, where when the electrons are raised up as a result of absorbing energy to higher energy levels, in the Balmer series they all jump down. We take a look at the hydrogen atom. They're normally here in N equals 1, but we'll see in the Balmer series when they jump up to higher energy levels, like for example here, we've got N equals 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is in the N equals 5 principal quantum number. When this jumps down, in all cases we'll consider jumps back down to N equals 2. That's what's being referred to here. The diagram below illustrates the formation of a series of spectral lines in the visible spectrum of electromagnetic radiation for hydrogen called the Balmer series. Now if you pause this slide for a moment and take in what you see. We're considering here the origin of the so-called Balmer series, and you see here the lines on the spectrum, one at 410, another at 434, and so on. This particular one here has got the shortest wavelength. What's the significance of that? Well, with the shortest wavelength, it's going to have the highest the longest wavelength, I should say, of course. This has got the longest wavelength. It's going to have the longest wavelength, the shortest frequency, and the lowest energy. And the explanation for it is that an electron that has initially been raised up to the third shell, N equals 3, has made this jump. It has fallen from this third energy level, N equals 3, not back down to its ground state, but back down to N equals 2, the second shell. And the energy emitted as a result of that has created this particular line on the spectrum. Here's the next line on the spectrum. It's got a shorter wavelength, therefore it represents more energy, or a wave with more energy than the other. And it's explained by an electron that has jumped from here as a result of absorbing energy up to N equals 4, which is up to here. It has jumped up to here as a result of absorbing energy, but as far as this line on the emission spectrum is concerned, it has resulted from that electron jumping back from N equals 4 down to N equals 2 again, and as a result emitting energy of a wavelength that has produced this line in the spectrum. Here's the next one at 430 nanometers. Here we have a shorter wavelength, therefore higher frequency and somewhat higher energy. And it's explained by an electron again that has originally been in its ground state here, having been raised up to this time N equals 5. So it has come up to here as a result of absorbing energy. And then as it's jumped back down to its more stable ground state, sorry, not its ground state, but certainly a lower energy state, N equals 2, so it's gone from N equals 5 down to N equals 2. In doing so, it has emitted energy which corresponds to a part of the colour part of the spectrum and has a wavelength of 434 nanometers. And then this particular one, what has happened is, again, an electron which has been in the ground state, N equals 1, has absorbed energy and has gone up to N equals 6, But then as it has jumped back down again, not to its ground state, but N equals 2, energy has been emitted in the form of electromagnetic radiation, this time higher energy than the others, in other words shorter wavelength or higher frequency, and it has created this particular band, this particular line in the spectrum. And that's an explanation of the so-called Balmer series. Notice that the transitions are from higher energy levels all down to the N equals 2 level, and it produces a series of lines. In the visible part of the spectrum, there may be lines produced elsewhere, but as far as the colour part of the spectrum is concerned, it produces lines which are now called the Balmer series. Again, you see, unfortunately, this is the other way around here. We're going from approximately 380 nanometers. This is about 380 here, nanometers, up to about 750 nanometers here. Remember again, Richard of York gained battle in vain. The colours of the rainbow, in this case the colours of the visible spectrum. Red light has got longer wavelength, therefore is lower energy than violet light. But in this case, and I don't like to see it done this way, but we do come across it in the books like this. In this case, energy from left to right, but from right to left. And as a result, you see the distance between the bands is decreasing. Look at the distance between these two bands. And then this distance is shorter, and this distance is shorter, and so on. This is the absorption spectrum. This is the emission spectrum. Why do these two match up? Two lines. This one here represents the fact that energy is being absorbed by the hydrogen atoms to bring about an event in the hydrogen atom where an electron makes a particular jump from one energy level to another. If electrons jump down from one level to a lower level, it represents the same relative energy change. This is why the lines on the two spectra should correspond. And here you see the Balmer series represented slightly different way. Here we've got N equals 1, the lowest energy level. And look at the Balmer series. We've got jumps from N equals 3 to 2. This is N equals 4 to 2. N equals 5 to 2, 6 to 2, 7 to 2, and that's what creates our Balmer series. After the Balmer series was discovered, two other series were subsequently discovered. Here we have the so-called Lyman series, L-Y-M-A-N. Look at those jumps. Those jumps are similar to the Balmer series, but instead of jumping down from higher energy levels down to N equals 2, they're the same, but they all fall down to N equals 1. Any idea why we cannot see lines for the Lyman series in the emission spectrum for hydrogen? Notice that these jumps are bigger jumps. They will represent electromagnetic radiation with higher energy, in other words shorter wavelength or higher frequency. Higher frequency, in fact, than or higher, longer, shorter wavelength than the wavelength represented by the visible spectrum, which I showed you as being between about 700 nanometers and 380 nanometers. These particular ones here, the Lyman series, the energy of those waves is of higher energy than those represented by the Balmer series. They will have shorter wavelength, and they occur in the ultraviolet part of the electromagnetic spectrum. And then you see there's yet another one here where the electrons jump from higher energy levels down to, in all cases, down to the N equals 3. And that's known as the Passion series or Paschen series. Just pause the slide and you can take those in. And it shouldn't surprise you then discovered another one where they're dropping down to N equals 3 and indeed down to N equals 4, giving us the bracket and the Puffin series. Pause again, this is another way of representing what's going on that creates these different series. The key thing is that they are jumping down from one level to another level. Notice as well as you get further away from the nucleus, which means you're going up from N equals 1 to 2 to 3 to 4, notice that the actual jumps or steps are getting smaller. Remember what I said earlier about comparing the ramp with the staircase, or comparing the old theory of energy being a continuum with the modern theory that energy exists in packets, or the quantum theory. We've been through this already. Just some other representations here of the same thing that you might find helpful. One from a French source here, obviously. And a reminder of why we don't see the Lyman series within the visible part of the spectrum. Those jumps represent jumps of higher energy, therefore longer wavelength, shorter wavelength or higher frequency, falling outside the visible part of the spectrum. Now, in terms of electromagnetic radiation, we need to learn just a little bit more about the nature of radiated energy. And here's a representation of an electromagnetic wave. Remember what a wavelength is, the distance between two peaks. Or indeed the distance between two troughs, two points of minima. Amplitude is not something we really need to consider. You see amplitude marked here. Why is it called an electromagnetic wave? If you pause this and look at this particular slide, it'll help you to understand why. According to this source, if you look at this diagram as I read, all electromagnetic radiation has fundamental properties and behaves in predictable ways according to basics of wave theory. Electromagnetic radiation consists of an electric field E, which varies in magnitude in a direction perpendicular to the direction in which the radiation is travelling. So the radiation is travelling in this direction here. In other words, the energy is travelling in that direction. And E, the electric field, is perpendicular to that. And then there's a magnetic field M, which is oriented at right angles to the electric field. We'll see that here. And both these fields travel at the speed of light, which is at the incredible speed of about 186,000 miles per second. So, in terms of an electromagnetic wave, it's got an electric component and a magnetic component. Here we see another representation of the same thing. We have the direction of the wave, we have the plane of the electric field, and we have the plane of the magnetic field. So here's the speed of light, 186,300 miles per second, or in metric 299,792 kilometers per second. How fast is that? Well, the moon's about 250,000 miles away, and light hitting the moon gets to the Earth in 1.3 seconds. The sun's over 90 million miles away, and the light from the sun reaches us in about 8.5 minutes. Pluto, which is, I suppose, near the edge of our solar system, or certainly way out there in our solar system, takes light 4 hours to reach the Earth from Pluto. And what about the edge of our expanding universe? It takes light about 10 billion years to reach Earth from the edge of our expanding universe. Gives you some idea of the size of our universe. Another slide worth looking at for a moment. In particular, helping to compare waves here of short wavelength with waves of long wavelength. So here we've got short wavelength, which is synonymous with high frequency and many waves passing per second, versus waves of long wavelength and therefore low frequency, few waves passing per second. Now, learning about how we obtain and interpret spectrographs. And in this section, we need to know, or need to learn, how to carry out an experimental study of flame colorations caused by the chlorides of these metals: lithium, sodium, potassium, calcium, strontium, and barium. We also need to be able to outline the process or processes that produce the flame colors. And as you'll see, they'll be similar to what we've learned already about hydrogen and the Balmer series. This is taken from a past paper question, this particular diagram. Here we've got a hydrogen discharge tube, and that will be, you can imagine that coming out of this is energy in the form of electromagnetic radiation, but the problem is you've got all these waves superimposed upon one another, different wavelengths. So you need something that's going to separate these waves and analyze them, and that's the role here of the prism. The prism will split the sample into its separate wavelengths of radiation, and then we can get the spectrograph here and analyze the spectrograph, looking at where the lines are occurring, the wavelengths of the radiation producing those lines. So we use an instrument called a spectroscope, designed for visual observation of spectra. That's what a spectroscope is. And we'll see the design of some of these in a moment. What's a spectrograph? An instrument that photographs or maps spectra. The typical spectroscope is a combination of a microscope and a prism. The prism breaks the light into its spectral components by differential refraction, which is then magnified with the microscope. The typical spectroscope is a combination then of the microscope and prism. And we see here a typical spectroscope. And if we take the top off here, we can see the prism inside. And then you'll have a series of lenses. This is a cheap one that might cost maybe £100 or so. And here you would view the flame. You would, for example, take a sample of a metal chloride, put it into a flame. And of course, you'll be able to observe the color of the flame. For example, potassium chloride will impart a lilac color to the flame. But you're not seeing everything there with your eye, whereas the spectroscope can see all the wavelengths of light being emitted from the Bunsen flame as a result of putting the potassium chloride into the flame. This was an advertisement that I got from the internet of someone selling one of these handheld spectroscopes. Spectroscope that provides the direct reading of spectral length and employs a prism for dispersion. It says there's a single eyepiece. I'm referring again back to this particular one here at the bottom right. There is a wavelength scale, and we can see this in some of the pictures they've provided. Like, for example, I can see it says 550 nanometers here. The amount of light admitted to the spectroscope can be regulated by a variable slit. It provides visible range and scale from 400 nanometers up to 750 nanometers, made of sturdy metal construction, it says. But you can see how you can read off the information by looking through the spectroscope. So while your eye might see that a sodium chloride put in a flame makes the flame go yellow, when you look at the flame with a spectroscope, you're going to get an awful lot more information, because it has split the different wavelengths of radiated light, and then with the help of the microscope it magnifies what you need to see, and with the help of the scale then you can see the wavelengths of the radiated light. On a large scale in industry, in a forensic laboratory, one carries out atomic absorption spectroscopy or atomic emission spectroscopy. And in this particular instrument here, around about here somewhere, typically it's used for analysing the presence of metals in compounds. The metal will be put into some fuel source that will burn, and you will aspirate or spray the metal sample into the flame. You can see here something that collects the fumes and extracts them. And then the spectroscope will analyze the flame and obtain an emission spectrum. It says here, since all atoms in a sample are excited simultaneously, they can be detected simultaneously by what's called a polychromator with multiple detectors. In a technique called atomic absorption, or AA as opposed to AES, one is, as far as I understand, analyzing or looking for one metal at a time. The advantage of this technique, because it's got these multiple detectors or a polychromator, if you've got several different metals in the same sample, it's capable of simultaneously identifying the presence of those, in other words, picking up all the data. And in the modern instrument, instead of getting what we've seen before, these spectras with lines getting closer together, instead it'll give this kind of printout here with line intensity as well. So you're getting troughs created on a graph, but they do correspond, as you can see here. And you'll see when we go to the university, local university, you'll see one of those in operation, I hope. Now, a few other things that are worth mentioning. The spectrum of an incandescent solid, a solid that's hot, and you analyze this very hot sample, it's said to be to form or to be continuous because all the wavelengths are present. Again, now we're talking here about a solid. We're talking about millions of different particles contained within that solid, and there's an awful lot going on. Lots of different energy jumps, jumps of electrons. All the possibilities being covered, and as a result, it's giving out literally all the possible wavelengths within the color part of the spectrum. And so the spectrum from a so-called incandescent solid is said to be continuous. Whereas the spectrum for an incandescent gas, on the other hand, is called a line or an emission spectrum, because only a few wavelengths are observed to be emitted. And these wavelengths appear, as we've seen, as parallel lines on the spectrum. So spectra may be classified according to the nature of their origin as either emission or absorption. An emission spectrum consists of all the radiations emitted by the atoms. An absorption spectrum, portions of a continuous spectrum, in other words, portion of the light containing all the wavelengths, are missing because they have been absorbed by the medium through which the light has passed. and I referred to that earlier. The missing wavelengths appear as dark lines or gaps. And here's quite a good illustration of this. So here's your heat source, and if observed directly, we're assuming this heat source is giving off all the different wavelengths within the colour part of the spectrum. But if we put the gas into this heat source, the gas will absorb some of those radiations, some of those wavelengths of light, so that electrons perform particular jumps from their normal ground state energy level up to higher energy levels, and as they take out particular wavelengths, we then see that those as being missing, and it causes these lines in the absorption spectrum. Literally, bits of this have been cut out. So see the absorption spectrum is essentially this spectrum, which has bits removed from it. Why? Because the gas has removed energy of that particular wavelength. Why? To make electrons make specific jumps from one energy level to a higher energy level. And what has happened here? Well, this same sample, what has happened is the gas particles, the electrons within the gas particles have taken the energy and they have made jumps to higher energy levels. And now what happens, as those electrons begin to fall back down to a lower energy level, not necessarily the ground state energy, they emit packets of energy, and those packets of energy come out with a specific wavelength, and this is what we observe. So these lines correspond to electrons jumping down, whereas these correspond to electrons jumping up. Just some more illustrations here. Let's look at this in two separate ways. We've got the Bohr hydrogen atom here. And look what happens. This is in terms of absorption, first of all. Let's consider what happens as this particular sample of hydrogen is exposed to some energy source. It takes out, it's just giving here, representing it by an arbitrary number 2. This particular wavelength of light, represented by number 2, happens to correspond to exactly the amount of energy required to make the electron jump from its ground state up to energy level 2. And if we observe over here the light that's got through, we notice that a bit's missing. And this corresponds to the hole, as it were, in the whole spectrum that we observed in the previous page. One of these lines created here. Now, in terms of the graph, if nothing was happening, then all the light's getting through here on the left hand side. But when an event takes place, when energy is removed, we notice, instead of the continuous line here, we notice an event has taken place. This is what causes these troughs that we saw earlier. Notice an event has taken place, energy has been absorbed of this particular wavelength, represented by. Now, separately, let's go to consider the opposite idea. If we observe the light that's actually coming from the sample, what is the sample emitting? Then it's taking an example here that the sample emits a wavelength which corresponds to this arbitrary number here, 3. And that's what you see coming out here. And in terms of this unaffected radiation here, we notice this is an event that when it comes to wavelength 3, we're getting light emitted of that wavelength from the sample as electrons jump down. So again, this represents electrons falling back down to lower energy levels, whereas this, in terms of absorption, represents electrons absorbing energy and jumping up to higher energy levels. few other points. A beam of photons contains many colors. It's not energy or radiation of a specific wavelength. Lower energy photons are red, and higher energy photons are violet. I already said that red is at one side of the color part of the spectrum, approximately 750 nanometers, and violet, around about 380 nanometers. The shorter the wavelength, the more energy in the wave. And as the photons pass through an atom, the orange photon with energy 2 in the previous example matches the energy needed to kick an electron from the zero state, or the ground state, up to the 2 state. And a photon is absorbed as it does this. At the same time, the yellow photon of energy 3, these are arbitrary numbers, stimulates the electron at state 5 to fall to state 2. And that's a different phenomenon there that's being described. This idea of stimulate. If there's an event that can take place within an atom, and a specific amount of energy is associated with that event, whether it be an event of jumping up or jumping down, if you supply energy that corresponds exactly to that amount, even though you're supplying energy, and this event will actually release energy, it simply stimulates that event to take place. That's what it's trying to tell us there. It says the results of the beam of light, and the result of the beam of light is a missing photon too, because light, or when the electron made that jump, it absorbed light of that particular energy, and then you get an extra photon 3 because the sample emitted light of that particular band of wavelength. Wavelengths of visible light. For the human eye, the visible radiations range from violet, in which the shortest rays are about 380 nanometers, to red light, in which the longest rays are about 750 nanometers. Solids, liquids, and dense gases glow at high temperatures. The emitted light, examined using a spectroscope, consists of a continuous band of colours, as in the rainbow, and we've got the memory aid here, and here we see once again the colour spectrum. Remember here that red is the weakest light, so we're going from about 750 nanometers here to about 380 nanometers here. A continuous spectrum is observed. This is typical of matter in which the atoms are packed closely together. For gases at low pressure, the excited atoms emit only certain frequencies that discrete lines along a frequency scale, an atomic emission spectrum is formed. That's the proper name for these spectra, an atomic emission spectrum. The spectral lines in the visible region of the atomic emission spectrum of copper are shown on the next slide. So have a look at this. The spectral lines exist in series in the different regions. So we are getting, as well as getting radiated energy that corresponds to parts of the colour spectrum, we will also get radiations in the infrared and the ultraviolet as well. But here we see those corresponding to the colour part of the spectrum for copper. The spectral lines in the series get closer together, just as we saw with the Balmer series, with increasing frequency. And each element has its own unique emission spectrum, its own unique fingerprint. So let's have a look at these now. And remember, you're supposed to know these for the chlorides of a number of different metals, which we look at now. Here's lithium, considered a crimson red. As far as your syllabus is concerned, it doesn't distinguish between these reds, just lithium is red. And this is what the emission spectrum looks like. This is what your eye sees, but if, as we've discussed earlier, with the help of a spectroscope, you get much more. You'll see, if you look closely here, some blue lines, as well as this red and orangey-red colour. So while you may have difficulty distinguishing between two types of red flame for two different metals, when you would take a look at their emission spectra, it would be easy to distinguish between the two. This is sodium. Again, this is what your eye would observe, an orange-yellow flame. But when we look at the spectra, we get an awful lot more detail. Something that stands out in particular for sodium is the so-called yellow doublet, or D-lines, which occur just below about 590 nanometers. But again, while the eye sees this orange-yellow flame, look at just how much detail the spectroscope picks up. That's its particular fingerprint. Here we see another example of the so-called D-line here, sodium D-lines. These are the exact wavelengths. It's dominated by the bright doublet. And look, for once we get a little bit of detail in this. Normally we just talk in terms of electrons dropping from one energy level to another, but here we see from the energy level diagram it can be seen that these lines are emitted in a transition from the 3p to the 3s. So those particular lines are caused not by electrons jumping from one quantum number to another, but from within a particular quantum number from one sublevel, a 3p sublevel, to a 3s sublevel. Here's the potassium flame test. Again, while we see a lilac flame colour, if we look at the spectrum obtained, we get an awful lot more detail. We see its particular fingerprint. Then rubidium, again, simply said to be red. Again, it has its own very distinct spectrum. There's no danger of us mixing up any two of these spectra. And here's cesium. This produces, imparts a blue colour to the flame. And again, its own very distinct emission spectrum. Here we have calcium, described as brick red, its own particular emission spectrum. Strontium, another red flame, but no problem in distinguishing it when we look at its emission spectrum. And copper, green or blue-green colours imparted to the flame. It has its own rich lines on the emission spectrum. And so, in just under an hour, we've completed the snapcast. And remember then, bite off what you can chew. And have a go at recording the main points. Sit down and record, before you forget, the main points from this particular snapcast. Thanks for listening.